各位，今
members, we are called to order the meeting of the security panel. It's already our appointed time, and we've also formed a quorum. The first thing on the agenda is confirmation of minutes of our previous meeting. On the 30th of November, the minutes were circulated to members. So far, the Secretariat has not received any proposal for amendments. So, do we agree that the minutes can be confirmed? Thank you. The second item on the agenda, information papers issued since the last meeting. We have quite a few. And the papers have also been circulated to members. Do members have any comments to raise on the papers? Ms. Amni Lau? Well, can you mention the information papers to us, please? Sure. We've got a letter from the Hong Kong Fire Services Department, Ambulancemen's Union, to the CE regarding the creation of new rank, job-related allowances, and meal break arrangements. Second paper, information provided by the administration on measures to combat theft of the luggage or belongings of taxi passengers by taxi drivers. The third, information paper provided by the administration on the arrangements for the National Day flag raising ceremony. Can we perhaps discuss this? We would like to discuss this item. I think this issue has been going back and flow to different panels, and at first you said that the HAB was responsible. It should be for the Home Affairs panel. Well, it's just for your information, and the item will be taken up by the HA panel. By the HA panel, I don't know what is the arrangement there, because the Home Affairs Bureau was the responsible bureau, and according to the police, they were asked to execute the order on that day, and they didn't have any role to play. Then we should let the HA panel know. All right, I hope that the HA panel will put this on the agenda, and please ask the panel to inform us so that we can sit in at that meeting. Thank you, Chairman. The next information paper is provided by the police on progress of the police investigation into complaints relating to an incident on the 30th of June 2012 in which a reporter was taken away for a 15-minute inquiry at the cruise terminal site in Kowloon Bay. What about the progress? Well, the information paper has been circulated to members. It depends on whether members have questions. So you don't intend to put it on our agenda, Chairman? Well, we asked for an information paper, and the paper is not for us, so I'd like to ask members whether we have any follow-up on the information papers. We're not discussing the specifics of the papers now. Mr. James Ho, Chairman, I have a concern. I hope we can have an item for the next meeting, but we'll deal with that later. I know, since you're on this paper. It was not the first time. The SAR government has been rather hostile to journalists. Only last night, when a reporter was covering a dispute or confrontation, and then the reporter was taken away by the police because he was at the scene. Knowing full well that he was there to cover the event, he was not one of the protesters. So I'd like to ask why the police are now so hostile towards journalists. I want the PPRB and the CNN management of the police, well, Things were a bit better after the incident involving Vice Premier Mr. Li Keqiang, but things have gone from bad to worse now. We're very concerned because reporters are our witnesses in many major incidents. We need them to report on the events so that we know the specifics. All right. Okay. Thank you. Chairman, I do agree with Mr. Toh. I've read the paper. And according to the paper, the person concerned was now seeking a civil claim, and usually the administration would claim that since it's a case sub judice, it could not comment on it. And I know that the Journalists Association is also complaining to the police. Now, if we cannot have this at our next meeting, please put it on our list of outstanding items. I was about to say that. I was about to go to the agenda for our next meeting. All right, two members have asked that this item be included on our outstanding list. The next is a letter from the FSD Ambulancemen's Union to the PCPD regarding the installation of video recording facilities inside ambulances. Yet next, letter from the Civil Human Rights Front regarding the police's handling of public meetings and public processions. Ms. Emily Lau. All right. It's called the organization is called the Civil Human Rights Front because the CP proposed that district councils should be consulted when it comes to the processing of applications of public meetings and public processions. Well, Chairman, as you know, most district councils are controlled by pro-China or pro-government loyalists. So those people's views don't have to be listened. No. All of a sudden, district councils are consulted on such matters. Do you think district councils have a lot of time? We have a few dozens of public meetings on a daily basis. Do district councils have a lot of time, and they will be given a bigger budget to deal with other things? All right. The Civic Human Rights Front is asking us about this, and do you know whether it's already decided? Has the mechanism been activated? Chairman, do you know? So, I have just seen a letter from the Civil Human Rights Front. I'm not aware of the progress of this suggestion. I am against this proposal. Ms. Sit Ho, Chairman. Regarding traffic diversions and other measures, it is but natural to consult the district councils. But I'd like to ask the police to tell us categorically whether applications of public meetings will not be approved simply because of objections from district councils. If that's the case, this is something serious because the right to hold public meetings and processions are, after all, basic human rights and are promised to the community. If this item is indeed to be discussed, then the point you made should be included. All right, we will talk about this later. We'll not talk about the contents of these papers. We will only talk about issues of concerns related to these information papers. Mr. James Toh, a letter from the FSD Ambulancemen's Union. So the letter was sent to the Privacy Commissioner for Personal Data and CC to us. In view of recent reports, I think we should ask the government for information as to why such facilities should be installed. So we should put this question to the administration on our own. Yes. All right, the last information paper provided by the administration, the procurement of long-range acoustic device by the police. It was an issue raised by Ms. Sitho, Ms. Emily Lau. Can we ask the administration to let us pay a visit to such devices or to take a look at such devices? I don't know whether we have to bring along our earplugs. I believe the administration, the police would welcome us to would welcome our visit. Yes, I will try to arrange. But the third item is items for discussion for the next meeting. The administration has got three proposals for us. In fact, there are two from the administration. First, upgrading of the Zhangguan O Police Division to a police district, and then use of force by the staff of the Correctional Services Department in penal institutions. These two are suggested by the administration. And a few members would like to put on our list of outstanding items the following. The incident when a reporter was taken away for an inquiry at the cruise terminal bay, a terminal site in Kowloon Bay. And second, consultation of district councils on applications of public meetings and public processions. And Mr. James Toh, I think public meetings and public processions should take precedence because we have a few coming. All right, we will mention this to the administration. Chairman, we agree that we should discuss that and we should invite the police to come. And shall we ask district councils whether this request was made by by themselves or, well, let's ask for a paper first. Just in case it was a proposal from the district councils, we should ask them for their justifications. If it's just a proposal by the administration, it's a separate issue. So can the secretariat go an extra mile and ask us and ask the district councils? Well, we are not inviting all 18 district councils to meet with us. At least we should be informed of the position. And when we meet with district councils, secretariat, please make a note here. Let's ask the district council representatives whether it was their request and whether there was such a need. I have a number of district councils waiting to meet with us. We have month meetings of district councils throughout the year. So let's take it up under this item first. Okay, then let's move on to the next item, and that is the administration's or results of study of matters raised in the annual report 2011 to the CE by the Commissioner on Interception of Communications and Surveillance. To facilitate our discussion, we have Mr. Lai Tong Kwok, Secretary for Security, with us, as well as Mr. Joshua Law, Permanent Secretary for Security, Ms. Carol Yip, Deputy Secretary for Security, Mr. Ko Dale, Senior Principal Investigator from ICAC, Ms. Eric Tong, Assistant Director of ICAC, Mr. Godfrey Kan, Senior Assistant Solicitor General from Department of Justice, and also Mrs. Millie Ng, Principal Assistant Secretary for Security. So we've got paper from the administration. And as per our usual arrangement, the Secretariat has written to the Commissioner on Interception of Communications and Surveillance, inviting him to attend. But Justice Saul wrote back to say that he did not consider appropriate for him to attend the meeting because he would be asked to discuss issues raised by his predecessor. So, you can refer to the reply in the annex.
We'll first invite the secretary to take us through the paper, please. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman, members. Concerning the report, the annual report of the Commissioner on Interception of Communications and Surveillance, is a report on the implementation of the ICSO, and according to the CE's direction on the 28th of November, we've already tabled the report to the Council, and a paper has been issued to the Security Panel explaining the administration's reply on matters raised in the report. The interception of communications and surveillance are very important to law enforcement, combating serious crimes and protecting public security. The ordinance was enacted in August 2006. It provides a statutory regime for the conduct of interception of communications and covert surveillance by the LEAs. The mechanism ensures a balance between effectively combating crime and protecting public security and vis-a-vis people's rights. The LEAs have the duty of uphold the law and combating crimes. Agencies intercepting communication and conducting covert surveillance have to apply for authorization under the law, and it will only be used to combat serious crimes, protecting life and property. It is not for the convenience of the government departments or individual interests. The Commissioner is an independent supervisory authority. It is to monitor the compliance of the LEAs. In terms of interception, the Commissioner in his report said that he observed that the LEAs did comply with the ordinance. And when the authorization is no longer needed or is not proportionate to the conditions, then the authority, or the LEAs, ceased the operation. The panel judges have been very strict in handling LPP cases. And if there is such a possibility after assessment, or if the authorization continues to take effect, additional conditions are also added. These conditions are strict, and it also has effectively protect people's right to get privileged legal advice. Concerning the matters of concern, there are four of them. First, the Commissioner comment on the listening to the outcome of surveillance results. Number two, training. Number three, LPP, and also irregularities and breaches in 2011. I will speak briefly on this and then listen to members' views. With regard to the first point, the former commissioner proposed to the administration giving the power to the commissioner to listen to the results of interception. We have an open mind. In principle, we do not object to that. In setting out the details, we try to balance the consideration of different aspects. The ICSO is based on two principles. First, it must be necessary and it must be proportionate. In terms of combating and detecting serious crimes and protecting public security, vis-a-vis protecting privacy and rights and LPP, in setting out the details, we have to balance, on one hand, to minimize the disclosure of the interception results and destroy such results when it's no longer necessary as soon as possible. On the other hand, we need to facilitate the commissioner in discharging his duties. Now, in our consultation, the stakeholders generally supports the extension of strengthening the duties or strengthening the capability of the commissioner in the supervision. There should also be adequate regard for against abuse and leakage of interception results. We are now consolidating the outcome of the views collected in the consultation, and we will make further reference to the views made by the commissioner. We are consolidating such views, and we are preparing drafting instruction. We plan in the beginning of in the first half of next year report to the panel the progress. As for the attitude and training of the law enforcement officers, the commissioner criticized the attitude of some of the law enforcement officers and lack of training. We treasure the comment very much, and we've asked the LEAs to review the relevant training requirement, internal guidelines, regular training, training on the management of the devices, so on and so forth. And we make sure that the law enforcement agencies will provide adequate training to all officers responsible for working under the ordinance, so that these officers have better understanding of the ordinance and the relevant procedures. This will ensure that the officers will deal with their work and discharge their duties strictly and comply strictly with all the requirements and details. As for LPP, we know that members are concerned about the LPP cases. In the annual report of 2011, the commissioner in Chapter 5 stated that there were 37 LPP cases, and three of them were considered by the commissioner to have obtained LPP or privileged information. The rest was related to assessment of the possibility of obtaining LPP in the operation and also change in risks, and reports were made to the panel judges. As for the three cases mentioned, there was no breach at all. The mechanism gives protection to LPP. It is to make sure that the officers will not make use of LPP obtained inadvertently and give them to the investigation officers. Such information cannot be used in the legislative in the legal proceedings. The LEAs have been adhering to the provisions strictly, and the commissioner has not found a single incident in which LPP information has been transferred to investigation officers or used in investigations. As for the breaches and irregularities in 2011, in Chapter 7, the cases were reviewed. Two cases were raised in the 2010 report but were not completed then, and 9 were breaches or irregularity reports received during 2011. We noticed that among these cases, the commissioner has not found anything in which the LEA deliberately ignores the law or deliberately not comply with the law. Or the breaches or irregularities are done out of ulterior motive. Most of the, all of them are inadvertently mistakes inadvertently made, or the officers are not not familiar with the procedures. Some of the departments handling the ordinance may have officers being changed from time to time, and there is lack of manpower or there is lack of supervision. The law enforcement agencies have already taken up the recommendations made by the commissioner and has also taken up follow-up action. The LEAs will continue to monitor the operation of the scheme and will cooperate fully with the commissioner and implement the ICSO. The Bureau has also amended the code of practice. The recommendations made by the commissioner in the 2011 report have all been implemented. Thank you very much. A show of hands, please, if you want to ask any questions. A show of hands, please. James To, Emily Lau, Wong Yuk Man, Lam Tai Fai, Alan Leung, Sid Ho. Can Dennis Kwok, Elizabeth Cut, Leung Kwok Hong, Chung Kwok, Mr. Chung Kwok Ban, and then Mr. Yik. 5 minutes each. Answer 5 minutes each, including answers and questions. Simple question, simple answer, please. Mr. James Ho.
Now, according to the commissioner, according to the secretary, there is no finding of deliberate breach. The reason is that the commission is not allowed to listen to the interception results. You keep talking like a tape recorder. You say there is no deliberate breach because the commissioner said so. The commissioner said so because he has no access to the interception results. You need the legislation so that the commissioner would be allowed to listen to the interception result. And the commissioner has also identified that some surveillance officers, they are the frontline officers, have not been given any orientation training. They just sit down and pick up and listen. They don't know when they should listen, when they shouldn't listen, when they should report. Now, for the experienced, the commissioner did praise them, but some have not been given any training. Is it really outrageous?
Or you have to bear in mind that you're against allowing the commissioner to have access to materials, claiming that more people that are privy to these information, the more possibility of breaches. But well, and a frequent change of personnel. This is strange. A dozen or so years ago, the group of people who were allowed to listen to such materials were very stable, and they were promoted to one higher rank. For instance, a constable would be promoted to a sergeant when he was posted to such a post, and he would be very cautious to ensure that he will not be posted out because he might be demoted. And yet the staff now has a high turnover. Is it because you think that it is better to have a more frequent turnover? Is it a very obnoxious job? But if you change the personnel very frequently without any training to newcomers, then people's privacy can be infringed very easily. And for senior officers of LEAs, when they argue with judges, I would say that they would have to have access or listen to such information before he knew whether there would be any LPP information related. We're not talking about junior officers. Even the senior ranking or supervisors were thinking like this. So training should not just be provided to the junior officers, but supervisors as well. So, Secretary, can you tell us whether you have checked personally with LEAs as to how training is provided and reasons for frequent change of staff responsible for surveillance duties? Secretary, the Commissioner proposed that the legislation be amended so that he or his staff could listen or have access to information obtained or intercepted information. We already said that we would give our full support to the Commissioner for carrying out his duties. If members have read the report, you might know that the Commissioner had made known his views in various parts of the report. We have some procedures to go through, and we're communicating with the newly appointed Commissioner, who would like us to approach his counterparts in overseas jurisdictions to obtain further information for his consideration. So, we hope that within the first half of next year, we can report to this panel the overall results of our work. As regards induction training for all officers involved, whenever an officer is newly appointed to carry out interception or cover surveillance duties, he would be given training to familiarize himself with the operation of the device, to understand the skills, and to understand what are the additional conditions imposed by judges as they give approval. Please allow me to finish in a minute. For newly appointed supervisors, they also are required to take such training. But I hope members understand that we do have staff turnover, and have asked relevant LEAs to minimize the need for change of staff, because, as Mr. Toh said, experience is of utmost importance. Thank you. Ms. Emily Lau. Chairman, you invited the Commissioner to come and he refused, claiming that he did not write the report himself. Chairman, you know that in the past, Justice Wu would not come to meet us in LegCo personally, but he would make an arrangement for legislators to meet with him. And then on one occasion, he said that he was very angry with the attitude of some LEA officers. This time, he didn't even have a chance to say this. I'm sure members remember how angry Justice Wu was, and I hope that we can have an opportunity to communicate with the new commissioner. And according to the Secretary, the administration is drafting an amendment bill hoping to incorporate all the recommendations by the commissioner. However, the SOS didn't make himself clear. Mr. James Toh asked about allowing the commissioner or his designated staff to listen to the outcome of interception cover surveillance. So please address this point, otherwise it will be very disappointing. In 2011, there was 1,204 applications, only 8 were rejected. So on average, 100 cases per month. Can the administration tell us? Given that we only have a million of 7 million in Hong Kong, is 100 cases per day or per month a lot or just right? Do we really have so many subjects in Hong Kong worthy of cover surveillance or interception? And for journalistic materials, there were 2 cases where JSM information was involved. And you say that you, according to the code of practice, LEAs are required to handle such cases as if they were handling LPP cases. Will legislative amendments cover this in the future? And for case 5, how was the incident exposed? Because of a report by the press. So I don't think you have to go as far as that, so long as you hear that the conversation is between the subject and an editor or a journalist, you should know. Well, if the case were not reported, would you not regard it as a JM-related cases and continue the interception or continue to listen to the recordings? The commissioner proposed that the law be changed to authorize himself or his designated staff to listen to the outcome of interception. We have no objection to this. We accept the broad direction of this proposal, and that's why we are in a dialogue with the new commissioner, who has asked us to check with his counterparts, overseas counterparts, and to gather more information on several issues. And this is in progress, but we do agree with the direction of the proposal. Regarding the number of cases, I'd like to point out that the number of applications depends on individual cases, because we have a very vigorous examination mechanism for all the cases. I think in previous meetings, some members asked, said that in other jurisdictions, the number of applications were on the low side, and we've done some research in this regard. And I can give you 2 figures. I dare not say that these places are entirely comparable with Hong Kong, but since Ms. Amilau mentioned this, let me give the following statistics for your information. In the UK, on average, there were 2,000 cases per year, and in Australia, around 4,000 cases per year. I hope members can note these figures. Regarding journalistic materials, the mechanism already provides a safeguard. Ms. Amilau referred to 2 cases. Well, in one case, it was just a technical breach. So the officers thought that there was some problem, and they went back to ask the panel judge for advice, and they were asked to discontinue, and so the operation was suspended. But of course, as mentioned in the past, there was a short time lag in between the 2 things. Ms. Wong Yok Man, I believe Mr. Justice Wu now feels rather, I think he left his position, his post, with regret and a sense of helplessness, because he had been in office for a few years, but every time his recommendations in the reports were just ignored, and the responses from the government were rehearsed again and again in this Council. I think I also made the same comments on the reports every year. Even I myself I'm bored with my own remarks. Mr. Justice Wu made some remarks, but because he's already left his post, he's more diplomatic this time. He said he had two wishes. First, he hoped that all LEAs under the ordinance would comply with the law in the conduct of interception and cover service operations willingly and entirely within the limits of the law. And secondly, he said that his report to that he hoped that his reports to the CE could grow thinner and thinner year by year. However, both of his wishes could not be fulfilled. Both wishes could not be reviewed because cases of irregularities and non-compliance were because of unfamiliarity with the law by some of the LEA officers because there was lack of training. And secondly, he was of the view that the attitude of some of the LEA officers were rather careless and they did not take the law seriously. And he hoped that if the commissioner was given the chance to have access to the products of such operations, perhaps it could be could be checks and balance to the performance of these officers, regardless of the cause of their non-compliance irregularities. However, he's been asking for this for many, many years, and yet, well, in 2008, that recommendation was mentioned in the annual report. 4 years have elapsed. How many 4 years do you have in a person's lifetime? And yet, the administration is still rather non-committed about these recommendations. It keeps saying that, well, there is room for improvement. It will continue to consider the recommendation. This is so, it really angers people. Mr. Wu has already left his post, and I think he must feel rather regrettable and helpless. And yet, the community is very angry. We have raised Mr. Wu's recommendation time and again, and the government's reply contains nothing new. Since you are a broken record, I might as well be the same to you, Secretary. To give the commissioner express power so as to expose irregularities and non-compliance of LEA officers. This is to protect our privacy and to protect human rights. So we have this ordinance, we have the ordinance, but they are here for window dressing. Fortunately, Mr. Justice Wu is not content to be a window window dress, and he has taken it serious, and yet the administration has yet to have an offer or review of the ordinance, regardless of the loopholes. For other ordinances, we have nothing to say, but for this, every year in the annual report, the commissioner asked you to review the legislation. Now, I still have 30 seconds left. I will continue. A few years, how many 4 years have you got in a lifetime? In a few years' time, you would retire and other secretary will resume office. So how long are you going to drag your feet? CY Leung likes to blame us for stalling. In fact, he is stalling, and you are stalling, and you have forced us to be the same. Mr. Lam Tai Fai. Understand that the ordinance can help LEAs to combat crime, to punish criminals, and to maintain law and order. Secretary, you were you are a local, and I'm sure you understand that protecting privacy and human rights are among the core values of Hong Kong. And I think you've been criticized heavily for striking a balance between combating crime and protecting human rights. Because if JM journalistic materials are compromised, then this will affect freedom of our press. And as Justice Wu said, some of the attitude, couldn't care less attitude of our area officers is worrying. I would like to know whether there is any abuse of power. You may say that those mistakes were inadvertent or careless, but regardless, you have to understand that Hong Kong people will suffer. Inadvertent or careless mistakes are not beneficial in crime fighting. It would infringe our privacy. And for a number of LPP cases, you had over 330, a figure higher than previous years. This sudden surge in such cases will cause people to doubt whether there is indeed white terror reigning in Hong Kong. And if you don't plug the loopholes, then we're worried that LEAs might abuse the powers. Even inadvertent and careless mistakes would cause us to think that there is collusion among LEAs. I have read the commissioner's annual reports, and he had elaborated on LPP cases. Is it that if an LEA has listened to LPP information, the office has really breached the law? For instance, if you have heard of, if you have listened to a conversation about unauthorized structures or illegal activities, will the officer immediately refer the case to the buildings department or to the relevant LEA? How can privacy be provided? How can you ensure that cases will not be complicated? Please explain to what that LPP is about.
Secretary, Mr. Lam mentioned JM, journalist material and legal privileged. I'll answer the question. First of all, there must be an affidavit given to the panel judge stating whether the applicant is of the view that the information obtained through interception would include LPP. An assessment has to be made, and the assessment has to be made in the form of an affidavit. And the panel judge, in making the approval, also set out conditions. When action is being taken, and when there is the possibility of getting LPP, then a report will have to be made to the panel judge. And then the panel judge will decide whether the authorization can continue. If authorization can remain effective, will there be further conditions? If there is possibility for involving LPP or actually involving LPP, 33 cases, but only 3 of them are real LPP cases. If you look at previous records, there is an increase in number of applications, because in 2010, Mr. Wu, Justice Wu, asked for a change in the reporting system. And in Chapter 5, he has pointed out that because of this, the number of applications increased. As for attitude, it should be improved through training so that they fully understand the requirement of the law. We agree with Mr. Justice Wu's view. We've also asked the heads of the LEAs to do their part fully. Mr. Alan Leung. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just now, our colleagues have quoted part of the report. It's really worrying. In Chapter 12, Acknowledgement and Way Forward, Mr. Wong Yuk-man was quoting 12.4. And in 12.5, Justice Wu said that his wish have not been realized because the law enforcement officers are not fully conversant with the requirement of the law, and also the officers in exercising their duties. The officers in exercising their duties have adopted a lax attitude. I just want to know why after 5 years the officers are not familiar with the ordinance. I hope that his answer will not be as empty as his kickoff speech. What we are discussing is the infringement of citizens' rights, in particular in relation to Chapter 5, LPP. And my question is also on why there is such the lax attitude. Do the LEA officers disregard the importance of privacy? Why there is such a view? The lax attitude is quite a heavy word, and I don't know what does the Secretary feel upon such a criticism. Now, when the bill was passed in this council, Ms. Margaret Ng of the Civic Party supported a sunsetting provision. This will force the authority or the administration to conduct a review. 5 years have elapsed. Justice Wu has made a number of recommendations which have not been adopted. After 5 years, does the administration have the intention to conduct a comprehensive review of the ordinance seriously? And if so, what is the exact arrangement? Now, concerning Para 1215, I have noticed that upon the report was given to the LegCo, whether it's before that day or on the same day. We can't hear you. The two paragraphs were also quoted. Now, the ordinance have been implemented for several years, and the commissioner has made new recommendations to deal with new circumstances. Every year, he came up with new recommendations asking us to amend the code of practice. That happens every year, and that happens under every system. The bill has been passed by the bill was passed by this council. Any system can be improved, and Justice Wu has played a very important part in this regard. He is very meticulous in his work, and many problems which had questions which had not been considered or foreseen have been identified, and therefore he has made such recommendations. As for the officers who make such have such non-compliance and irregularity were because of unfamiliarity of certain rules and procedures, and that's why we step up the training. We've asked relevant LEAs to provide training and refresher training for the officers. Chairman, if I may have a few more seconds, we will continue to conduct our review on this. As for 12.5, secondly, the blame can be attributed to the lax attitude of some LE officers. I read the report. I think the commissioner was the commissioner referred to the daily devices which do not belong to interception devices, and some colleagues in the register made certain records which were inaccurate. He was referring to the devices not used in interception operation. Mr. Ho.
Thank you. I want to ask the Secretary. Justice Wu is very dedicated to his job of supervising and monitoring the interception of communication. The LEA regard the Commissioner, Justice Wu, as a hurdle, as an impediment. Just like Mrs. Carrie Lam just a while ago said that the administration or the civil servants consider the ombudsman as a hurdle. I think Mr. Justice Wu is very dedicated and he has discharged his duties fully. I just want to know whether the Bureau is trying to find evidence to prove that Justice Wu has no power to listen to the product of interception. The Bureau asked the Justice Department to seek information from Canada to support this argument. Now the present Secretary says that the law will soon be amended. And Mr. Lee, the previous Secretary, said that the law would be amended, but we have not seen an amendment to the law. I want to know whether your amendment is to give power to the Commissioner, the power to listen to the product of inception, or you just cross out the provision in the law to take away the power to listen to the the intercepted communication. Next year, you will have the bill. You should tell us now what you are thinking. If the commissioner does not have the power to listen to the product of interception, if you look at 5.90 concerning journalistic material, and there were four reports, and concerning the reference to what is meant by JM, there is difference in understanding. REP 11 report to the panel judge and the letter to the commissioner said that that might amount to possible JM, but the weekly report classify this as JM has been involved or obtained through interception. The weekly report to the panel judge is that no journalistic material had been obtained. How many people wrote the report or wrote the reports? Is there any suspicion of trying to deceive the panel judge? Now, there was communication between the panel judge and the commissioner, and the discrepancy was found. Now, if the same person wrote all these reports, was the person penalized or disciplined? If the reports were written by different people, then who is the supervisor supervising all these people? And the training is very inadequate. They just don't know what is journalistic material, and only when something is reported in a newspaper, then they know that it is journalistic material. You are abusing power in the name of ignorance. As long as you don't know whether it's journalistic material, you continue to conduct interception. I think you don't have enough time to answer all these questions because of the shortage of time. Now, law enforcement agencies, the panel judges and the commissioners have each of their own role to play. We do not believe that Mr. Justice Wu is standing in the way of the LEAs, the disciplined forces, and the commissioner have their own roles. What about your role, your direction of law amendment? I've already answered the question many times before. You're very concerned about authorizing the commissioner and his officers to listen to the product of interception. We accept the general direction in principle, and we are talking to Justice Saw on this matter, and he asked us to obtain overseas examples, and we are dealing with that. If the chairman permits, I will ask my colleague to speak on the JM case. I don't allow Mr. Dennis Kwok. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to thank Justice Wu on behalf of the legal profession for his good efforts as the commissioner, and we would like to pay our tribute and give our thanks to him. Now, the secretary says that there are new officers who are not familiar with procedures, but concerning the 37 cases of LPP, in the report, the commissioner in 5.24 mentioned that the officer who had the breach was a senior officer. He could not be unfamiliar with the procedures. There are law enforcement officers who inadvertently make a mistake and listen to LPP in 560, paragraph 560. Some law enforcement officers said that they breached the rules because of ambiguity in communication or misunderstanding. But the commissioner was of the view that the officer did not provide adequate correct information to the panel judge. So the statement that the officers are not familiar with the law and therefore they have the breaches, that's not the case, in fact, according to the commissioner. Now, the Law Society and the Bar Association have stated time and again that the ordinance is not adequate to safeguard human rights. The commissioner has mentioned many times in the report, this year there were 37 cases, an increase of 40%. When will you face to the music and try to amend the law and then protect people's rights?
Secretary, regarding the question related to paragraph 5.60, I'd like to quote from the Commission's report. The head of the LEA concluded that this was a case of misunderstanding arising from ambiguity in communication, and he agreed that the matter was unsatisfactory and stated the officer concerned had been reminded of the importance of verifying the accuracy of information before passing the same to me or my office, and that is it is important for LEA officers to verify the accuracy of information. So the head of the LEA concerned agreed that the matter was unsatisfactory and improvement had to be made, and I asked my colleague to supplement. Mr. Kwok mentioned paragraph 5.24 and said that these were not really junior ranking LEA officers, so how come they also made that mistake? And I think that was a case involving LPP information. If we refer to the facts of the case, I think it will be easier to understand. The person concerned thought that it was about information submitted to the court, and he thought that it was already in the open domain, but the commissioner felt that although it was public information, still it was LPP information because it was for the court. So there was some misunderstanding. So I think both LEA officers and commissioner would like to perfect the understanding of colleagues of the law. Well, all right. LPP information is not a legal concept that difficult to understand. You can ask any undergrad of law, and I'm sure he will understand, any student of law. And I don't think this mistake can be made. Well, the facts were there. There was some misunderstanding. He thought that it was open information. It did not involve LPP information. We accepted that there was a mistake, and we promised to provide more training for officers. And the commission was satisfied with our follow-up action. Mr. Kwok said that there was a 40% increase because of that there were 37 cases. But paragraph 5.3 said that in order to have better understanding of such cases, I've directed the LEAs to give me a similar notification of each of such occurrences as if under COP 120. This resulted in the increase of the number of LPP reports from them. Ms. Elizabeth Quart, thank you. Reading the cases in chapters 5 and 7, there's case of the public to be worried because we are afraid of possible abuse of power by LEAs because they enjoy such great powers. And we are worried whether the LEA officers' attitude were indeed too lax and that they were not vigilant enough. In addition to training, I have two concerns for the administration. For instance, para 2.38 of cap 7, that is cap 3237 and chapter 7, it is said that some information can be kept. I'd like to know whether there is any tool to prevent officers from keeping or jotting down products of interception, because there are tools and software available in the market to know who has have access to such information and whether that person is eligible or entitled to keep that information, and that such information can be destroyed after a certain period of time. And chapters 5 and 7 also talked about possible cases of contradiction. When the commissioner questioned the LEA officers, there were responses such as could not recall, could not you could understand why that has happened, because it was so long ago, so and so forth. The decision and process of each operation is very important. If after some period of time the officers concerned cannot recall the justifications and the reasons for such operations, then the public may not know whether such operations were necessary. So how can the administration resolve this problem? We cannot just rely on the memory of officers in making judgment. Secretary, LEAs have to submit in an affidavit or writing to a panel judge when seeking approval authorization, and they also have to report regularly to the commissioner, and as a result the commissioner can monitor the actual work of LEAs. So the role of monitoring is played by the commissioner in this way. Ms. Quart referred to a specific case. May I point out that the case was related to some internal control measures adopted by that LEA, and as a result, the case was reviewed. Because irregularities were involved, the LEA concerned had made a report to the commissioner in accordance with their code of practice and the relevant legislation. The commissioner directed that the LEA should conduct an investigation, but for the officer concerned, because he was involved in another case, the commissioner directed that investigation could only be done after that case was completed. No, Secretary, I'm sure the purpose of Justice Wu's quoting cases were to point out some loopholes of the whole system. I don't want to go into the specifics of each case. I'm asking whether there is any measures or mechanism to ensure that loopholes are plugged. When there is a problem, the commissioner would usually investigate whether any there is any LEA officer in the wrong. If yes, the commissioner require the relevant LEA to take disciplinary action. And secondly, the commissioner would give suggestions to the relevant LEA to make improvements, and that can include amending the code of practice to avoid a future occurrence. Every year, the commissioner would make such recommendations, and we will act according to the recommendations of the commissioner. Mr. Liang Kuo Hong, somebody, an official called Lee Ma, said that doesn't whether you ridicule me or criticize me, doesn't matter, I'll continue to be a good official. But nowadays it's different. Whether you criticize me or ridicule me, I will still be promoted. Well, you were the undersecretary when this report was published, and if you had rectified or dealt with this problem satisfactorily this time, I can commend you. Unfortunately, you haven't. And during Mr. Deng's days, administrative order was tantamount to legislation, and I sought a judicial review. Now, I can recall two members who have already left us, one Ms. Margaret M, another Mr. Lau Kwong Wah. Ms. Margaret M knew well beforehand that you would certainly run into trouble because you tried to pass the legislation so rashly, and so she proposed a sunset clause asking for the bill or the ordinance to be reviewed after 2 years' time. And Lau Kwong Wah, representing the DAP back then, was so smart. He said that if the amendment was passed, then we would let the big robbers away. And as a result, not even one amendment was passed. And yet, Ms. Margaret M asked for a sunset clause. You supported the rubber stamps in this council. Have you forgotten your undertaking? You promised to review the legislation. So for 6 years, you have not really acceded to this request by Mr. Justice Wu. He wanted to have access to the products of your interception, and yet he's not given this express power. Now, if you do not give me the power, how can I monitor you, Secretary? If you had not required Justice Wu to submit this annual report, how could I how could I have monitored his performance? For so many years of not amended legislation and LPP information. How difficult it is. You should have been arrested for listening to a conversation between a lawyer and a certain subject. And yet, you had deliberately bucked the telephone or the lines of a law firm. What was the purpose of your interception? To hear whether somebody was going to sell a motor car, or whether Mr. Lam Feng Kong was about to sell his flat? Wu Kuo-hing has been very courteous. He said that your attitude is lax and unfamiliar with the law. In fact, it's all because of the senior management. You have been also lax. You don't give them any training. If listening to LPP information can lead to prosecution, will this happen? Do you agree that such people who listen to LPP information should be prosecuted? Justice Wu was trying to be courteous, and yet you thought that, but you were so complacent. When a barrister said that I humbly submit, that doesn't mean that he's really humble. He's trying to be courteous. All right, Justice Wu was he felt helpless and frustrated. How are you going to address that issue? Ms. Margaret asked for a sunset clause. She had the foresight to ask for that. I really miss her. And then, for those who rubber-stamped your bill, how come they have the face to comment on this year? Not even one amendment was passed. It's all because of the small circle election. People are loyalists. Well, Elizabeth Kwok is very eloquent this afternoon. Had Ms. Margaret M's sunset clause been passed, the bill would have been amended 2 years after its passage, and Gary Chen can also offer some help. And then I think we should remember who voted against Ms. Margaret M's amendment.
No, GJ.
Mr. Chung Kwok Pan. Concerning LPP, the communication between the lawyer and his client should not be intercepted or disclosed. One way to protect this is to reduce the chance of getting such information, but the commissioner proposes to listen, proposes that he should be given the right to get in. To get such information, and is there any checks and balance if such a power is given? Now let me respond first, and then I'll ask the DOJ representative to explain the arrangement of LPP. Now in July and October last year, we explained to members the recommendation, and we will support the commissioner in discharging his duty of supervising the implementation of the ordinance. And we accept the general direction of the recommendation, and that is to empower the commissioner and his officers to listen to the product of interception. Now we will find a balance. That is, on one hand, try to reduce the disclosure of such information and destroy them as soon as possible when the information is no longer necessary, and facilitate the monitoring of the commissioner. Is there any concern about the community with regard to allowing the commissioner to have access to the interception product? Some stakeholders have asked us to have a suitable checking mechanism to prevent such interception product from being leaked or disclosed. We understand such view, and Commissioner Wu, in his report, has also responded to that.
We will continue to talk to Justice Saw, the new commissioner, on this matter. And then I'll invite the DOJ colleague to speak on LPP, and in particular, the telephones of the law firms. Mr. Khan.
Thank you, Chairman.
With regard to LPP, it is based on Article 35 of the Basic Law, which give rights to the people of Hong Kong or to have private legal advice. According to the ordinance, Section 3 requires the authority in giving the authorization has to balance various rights, including the right to privacy, and also LPP enshrined in the Basic Law. And therefore, Annex 3 of the ordinance also require a prior assessment, and the panel judge will have to consider whether such an application is in line with the requirement of Section 3. And also Section 31 states very clearly that if a certain operation is against a certain law firm or the communication device of any law firm, that is prohibited unless it is under a special situation. The threshold is very high. The law does not say that as long as it is communication of a law firm, interception is not allowed. The most important thing is that the operation has to be conducted in compliance with the ordinance. Section 62 also provides that in the LPP information obtained in covert operation, in covert surveillance, will continue to enjoy the LPP. Now, if there is any increase in risk of getting information of LPP, a report has to be made to the panel judge. Mr. Yik.
Thank you, Chairman. Many members criticize the administration and said that the frontline officers are not given adequate training and they have a lax attitude. Now, we have businesses. If you drive a bulldozer, you really need to be trained and get a license. You need to be an authorized driver. I want to know whether the administration will adopt such an approach. And when we watch films, we saw that when the telephone is ringing, then the interceptors, the listeners, would be very excited. I know that there is division of labor. Is it that when there is a when the telephone is ringing, when there is a telephone conversation, they just record this and they don't listen? And is there any system in which the officers are required to fully understand the requirements so that they can protect the rights of citizens? Now, the LEAs in designing their training courses will consult the commissioner. And also, and every year, the commissioner makes recommendations on certain changes. The commissioner and his colleagues talk to the LEAs on areas in which training should be provided. As for the LEAs, with regard to induction courses or refresher courses, emphasis will be put on new cases. We agree with the commissioner that some of the colleagues have not met the requirement or standard.
Now the commissioner therefore said that there was not enough induction training for new entrants. We've asked the heads of LEAs to work on this. It's not just in the induction courses or beginners courses, but in terms of operation of device and also in terms of refresher courses, and also concerning the supervisors, there should be more training. We will talk to the commissioner and ask the commissioner to give his advice on our training materials. We'll ask the commissioner to advise on the areas in which training should be stepped up and areas in which more emphasis should be given. I hope the member will understand that the system is only limited to a small number of officers in the of the LEAs and also the officers of the commissioner. Having a authorization system or certification system may not be appropriate, but we do. We will ask the commissioner to advise us. The commissioner will continue to exercise his supervisory power, and I hope that next year in his report, the commissioner may become more satisfied with our work this year. Mr. Ronnie Tong, I'm really I think the paragraph that sent shivers down my spine is that certain law enforcement agencies have adopted certain arrangements so that his work, the work of commissioner, has become difficult. And concerning the LEAs referred to in the report, does the secretary knows this, and why the LEA officers of the view that under being supervised is not acceptable, being regulated by the law is not acceptable, why LEA officers have such an attitude? It is paragraph 16 of the summary. Paragraph 16 of the summary. Yes, please let me flip over the page. Yes, I've read this. I'm turning to that, but I don't want to waste your time. Whether it involves a LEA or several LEA, the commissioner does not express it, does not express the detail in the report. But having read the report, don't you feel a shiver in your spine? I'm trying to answer your question. Why don't you conduct an investigation? Which LEA has such a defensive attitude? Don't you think you have the responsibility to find it out? Yes, the commissioner does mention this in his report. And if I can recall, he has raised an issue of his concern with the head of the LEAs. And the heads of the LEAs have responded to the commissioner, reiterating that all the LEAs are subject to the monitoring of the commissioner. As for the attitude of certain officers, the LEAs will follow up the matter seriously. And afterwards, a report will be made to the commissioner. So you can answer my question now. How many LEAs are involved which have such a defensive attitude? what departments? As for the specific departments, it is not appropriate for me to disclose. Why? As far as I know, it's one department. Why it's not appropriate? Because in the report, we do not point out which LEA. We need to respect the commissioner. This is his approach in writing up reports. He does not mention the name of the department. The commissioner has adopted this approach to make his report. How will you follow that up? How will you follow up? Mr. Tong, it's not an exchange between you and the secretary. You should speak through the chair. Mr. Chairman, may I ask through you how the secretary follows the matter up? On this matter, the commissioner has already raised his concern with the relevant head of the LEA, and the head of the LEA has already said that he would conduct an investigation. The commissioner has a supervisory role or monitoring role, and the relevant LEA therefore has the responsibility to respond and conduct an investigation. And then after the investigation, a report will be made to the commissioner, and then the commissioner will look at the report, and if in the report finds that certain colleagues have to improve their ways of handling matters, or if their colleagues have made any mistakes, or if any disciplinary action is to be taken, a recommendation will be made to the commissioner. And then the commissioner, having read the report, will give his advice to give his view to the commissioner, to the head of LEA. And then the head of LEA will then make a final decision as to whether disciplinary action will be taken against certain officer or officers. Mr. Chairman, I want to know, my question is how the secretary is going to follow that up. He has not answered my question. Mr. Kwok Wai Kang.
Chairman, I believe ordinary members of, usually members of the public, will not be subjects of interception of communications. But looking at the report, we saw many man-made mistakes, wrong press of button, careless, lack of training, not professional enough. As a result, LEA officers will accidentally come into contact with information that was not required in the first place, and members of the public would worry for their privacy. This ordinance has been implemented for almost 6 years, and we hope that Justice Wu's to be thinner and thinner, because as people are more familiar with the legislation, there should be less material for Justice Wu to write on. Unfortunately, the report has grown from a few hundred or so pages to start with to 300 odd cases. And then Justice Wu was not just referring to training, but attitude as well. So many things have happened, and there are more concerns and more complaints. I'd like to know what the LEAs will do to improve the situation, to ensure that law-abiding citizens will not become subjects of such surveillance. Secretary, first, I want to point out that when we carry out such operations, we are required by the law. We have to go through a mechanism to ask for the approval of panel judges. So an officer cannot act arbitrarily, and only when it is for the investigation of serious crime and in full compliance with the law and after the approval of a panel judge, can such operations proceed? And as seen in the report, there have been cases of inadvertent mistakes, technical breach, and unfamiliar with the legislation. We entirely agree to the points made by Justice Wu. And to target this problem, I've asked heads of LEAs to enhance training of officers, and officers must be ensured to carry out their duties in a serious and stringent manner, and they must strictly adhere to all the details of the procedures. I'm sure everyone here would like to see the report growing thinner and thinner, as suggested by Justice Wu. I myself and my colleagues must work double hard to ensure this to happen. Mr. Kwok. All right. The Secretary replied that training would be upgraded, but I think we're also concerned about the attitude. How can we improve people's attitude, such as jotting down wrong names and then changing the names of the dates of issue of devices on the officer's own initiative? I think these are very problematic, and how can you improve the situation by enhancing monitoring? Well, wrong names, wrong dates, those devices were not really for interception or surveillance, cover surveillance devices. Still, Justice Wu always asked officers to record such things properly and do it well. As the report pointed out, individual officers was not careful enough, was not meticulous enough, and so since we're aware of this, we have to enhance the supervision of all ranks. Justice Wu devoted a lot of passage in Chapter 4 to iron out the details. I will not repeat his points here, but I think such detail elaboration has given us a timely warning or reminder. It's a timely reminder for all LEAs. They should do their job properly. The last speaker, Mr. James Tan. Thank you, Chairman. All right, I have read the last three paragraphs, starting from para 20, and the Commission expressed two wishes, and I believe it is the LEA's responsibility, because if LEA officers are not familiar with the rules and laws, they should certainly be trained, and lacks attitude. This is a very worrying. Is there a direct correlation between training and attitude? Is it a person who has received 100 training with certainty has a good attitude? That's not necessarily the case. I say attitude is something from the heart. When I was the chairman of the KCRC, well, just to digress, and I was asked to be the chairman of the KCRC because the officers were found to be rather lax, and there was no control or no monitoring. And then I found out that the disciplinary or the penalty system was very loose, and there was no actual consequence for an officer or a staff member who had committed any mistake. And I tighten up the penalty system, and even a warning, a verbal warning would be given if a staff member was on the wrong. I thought it was just a question of accountability, but then the staff felt that I was there to allot blames, and as a result they became passive and they decided not to be too proactive to avoid making mistakes. And this has caused me to understand that to improve the morale of an organization, you must strike a very be able to make the fine balance well between penalty and award. I'd like to ask Secretary whether he has been careful in striking this very fine balance, or is it that he's of the view that or will he take successful cases for granted? Now, if a proper balance is not yet struck, is there anything the Secretary do to ensure that staff has the right attitude and do things out of their heart? Secretary, I agree that LEA officers should do things out of their heart and they should discharge their duties properly. It is their duty. And for officers that have made any mistakes, then we should take disciplinary action based on the merits of the case and in accordance with established rules. We had communication with the Commission on such matter. When an LEA discovered anything, any irregularity, it has to submit a written report to the Commissioner and to carry out an investigation as directed by the Commissioner. If after investigation it is found that there were some officers were lacking in their discharge of duties, then depending on the severity of the case, disciplinary action might have to be taken. It could mean a verbal warning, reprimand, or in writing or in or verbally. And when there is any disciplinary action, it will be recorded in the relevant file of the officer. And according to established procedures of the government, such records will be considered in the promotion and transfer of the officers concerned. So we have established this mechanism with the commissioner. If after an investigation the head of the LEA has formed a certain view on the matter, he will inform the commissioner of the disciplinary action he is contemplating, and the commissioner can then comment on whether the action to be taken should be more severe or lighter. We have such examples in the report. There were cases where the commissioner was of the view that no disciplinary action was needed or the proposed disciplinary action was appropriate. So we follow our established procedures and people will know that we are fair and just. If a person has committed or has made any mistake, then we will penalize him according to our established procedures. And an officer who has been successful in cracking a case will also be reflected in his personal file. Thank you. More than 10 members have asked questions, and I hope that the Secretary notes that we're all concerned about giving the Commissioner express power to have access to the products of interception, and that the law be amended to this effect. I think the Secretary understands that we are quite concerned about that. All right, we will end the discussion of this item here, and we go on to the fifth item, and that is immigration, new immigration control system to support control point operation of the Immigration Department. We've overrun severely. It's already 4:13. I'll exercise my discretion as the chairman to extend our meeting by 15 minutes. I hope we can put our questions to the administration. I understand the paper properly within half an hour. All right. For this item, we have Mr. John Lee, Undersecretary for Security, Mr. Billy Wu, PAS for Security, Mr. Corrado Chow, Assistant Director of Immigration Department, and Mr. Eric Zhang, Assistant Director responsible for control from the Immigration Department, and Ms. Caroline Fan, Chief Systems Manager of the department. Mr. Lee, I understand that you have prepared a PowerPoint presentation. I hope you can do it concisely because we are already pressed for time. Over to you. Thank you. Chairman, I will give an overall introduction and then I'll invite my colleague to give a more detailed presentation using PowerPoint. Starting from the 1980s, the ID Immigration Department has been strategically adopting information technology to support its day-to-day operations. And the Immigration Department has tried to catch up with new developments. Starting from 2004, we've introduced e-channels for citizens of Hong Kong. And we've also extended that in 2006 to frequent visitors of Hong Kong so that they can use self-help services in our immigration clearance. Well, the number of visitors have increased substantially, and it's necessary for the Immigration Department to upgrade and renew its IT so as to increase its capacity so that it can enhance the efficiency at its control points and to cope with new businesses. Furthermore, IT has developed in leaps and bounds, and the Immigration Department would like to take this opportunity to introduce new technology, including face recognition technology and automated passenger clearance system. This will boost the department's service to the public. Subject to the approval of this panel, we tend to apply for funding from the FC early next year, and we expect that the new system will be commissioned in phases from 2015, end of 2015 and the middle of 2016. Members, Chairman, with your permission, I'll invite Ms. Fan to give you a PowerPoint presentation.
Ms. Fan, thank you, Chairman. I'll give you a summary and then a background, and then our proposal, financial implications, and timetable.
Our system is called the ICONS, the Immigration Control Systems. It is to update the system so as to enhance our capacity at our border checkpoints and keep pace with rising demand for immigration clearance. The ICONS will replace the old system, and we will enhance the e-channel service. We'll increase the number of e-channels, expand our service to other clients, and we also consolidate our system and improve automation. All along, we have been reviewing our information system, and the review of ISS 3 was completed in 2010. It was a plan to map out for our future development in 10 years to support our work. And the review proposes 8 strategic systems. The first one was submitted to the panel, and that is for the introduction of new information infrastructure system, and we obtained funding in October for the implementation of the system last year. As for the ICONS, it is a second item of this strategy. This new
item, first for this new item, the feasibility study was completed in July. We found that the present system has the following features. Now, the system was launched in 2004. It has been used for nearly 10 years. The hardware and software have been outdated. The maintenance and repair and expansion of the parts are getting more and more difficult. The system is operating near capacity. In the past 5 years, the number of visitors to Hong Kong increased on an average rate of 10.76%, and the growth in mainland visitors increased by 16.61% year by year. Our present system is not able to cope with continuous increase in visitors. In the coming few years, we'll continue to have new border checkpoints. The system near separation cannot be expanded further to meet the needs. We need a new system to support our development. And because of this, we propose a new ICONS immigration control system, which will be equipped with bio features, systems that can accommodate bio features, and there will be an integration of a 4 existing system, and they include Express, APVCS, Faces, and DICS. The system will be made of cloud computing and virtual technology to enhance our flexibility, and this will also enhance our flexibility. The new system will also keep pace with the the popularity of electronic travel documents, and we will make use of bio data to enhance immigration control. In terms of the e-channel, there will be enhancement. We propose to add 100 or more multi-purpose e-channels. We'll enhance existing 430-odd e-channels into multi-function e-channels. There will be fingerprint and face recognition systems so that we can easily deploy the e-channels for our own residents and also for our visitors. This will enhance the capacity of our border control points. As for visitors who have electronic travel documents, we will have a brand new technology. This will make use of electronic travel documents with adequate security. This can enhance the efficiency of our immigration checkpoints. This will is expected that by 2016 to 2017, we'll be able to save about 176 posts involving staff costs of about $70 million, and by 2020-2021, the amount, number of posts saved is 426, amount of staff cost saved is $228 million. Our proposal is cost-effective. It is expected that by 2019-2020, we will be able to break even. The table in front of you shows you the 5th year or after the launch of the system, and that is until 2020-2021. We expect an accumulated savings of about $126 million. If we get your support, we prepare to go to the Finance Committee for funding in early 2013 with the approval of the FC. The system can be launched, and the project can be completed in June 2016. We have to go through tendering, system analysis, design testing, so on and so forth. Thank you. According to rule procedure 83A,
If members have any direct or pecuniary interests in respect of the matter that is under discussion, the member will have to declare such interest before he or she speaks. Ms. Emily Lau, Ms. Elizabeth Cart, Mr. Yu Xiu Wing, and who else? Mr. Paul Che, Mr. Yi Qiming. 3 minutes each. Ms. Emily Lau. Thank you, Chairman. I support this because it's needed. On many occasions, we say that the Immigration Department offices have a lot of have a heavy workload, and they're really complaining. They said that by 2020-2021, they will save about $100 million. Well, we've heard it clearly, and we'll check whether by then you will save that much. As for manpower, you say you will be able to save manpower. Is it really so? It seems that they are working really hard. I'm not asking you to throw away money, but you really need to be kind to the immigration officers, in particular those at the border. Sometimes they were abused, verbally abused. Sometimes they were being beaten. Now, when you go to overseas countries, the immigration officers looks very strong and powerful. But why our immigration officers have to suffer that and continue cloud computing? Are you sure about its security? The secretary. Thank you, Ms. Lau, for the question. I agree with Ms. Lau in terms of management. In dealing with boring tasks such as immigration clearance, we try to computerize the arrangement. Therefore, the Immigration Department proposes to increase the number of e-channels by 100 or so from 430, an increase of about 25%. This will help to reduce the manpower of the Immigration Department because capacity will be increased by 25%, and that will save 25% of the manpower. It is the same. We are working towards the same direction. While we increase the e-channels, we also turn the counters into e-channels. The size of two counters can accommodate three e-channels. So we are thinking in the same direction of Ms. Emily Lau. We'll try to computerize the work so as to reduce the need for manpower. And the more mundane task can be taken up by the machine rather than by our colleagues. As for immigration officers being unfairly treated by visitors, through our training, we're happy to see that our colleagues have such a high quality, and we can only take action against them unless they breach the law. Ms. Quat, the DAB supports the enhancement of the icons, and we think we need the technology that facilitates our people and the visitors. That's also good for fighting terrorism. Do we need to store a lot of electronic travel document information of overseas citizens? Are there any guidelines, international guidelines? I also hope that the administration will adopt green technology so as to save energy. You may need a data center. I hope you will consider using green technology. The secretary. I thank Ms. Quart for the question. Concerning the storage of information, the present system requires that, the new system also requires that. Under the new system, the storage of new storage of information will be similar to that of the old system.
Now we've introduced face recognition technology. In the first phase, it has to be registered, and one has to apply, and one has to agree to allow the immigration department to obtain such information. This is in line with the privacy ordinance. This is also in line with privacy guidelines and also information disclosure guidelines. And this is also similar to international practice. As for departing visitors, they don't need to be registered and they can make use of the passport to leave. We do not obtain any information, we do not keep any information on that. That is checking of data from the electronic travel document. We do not do more, and we do not ask for more information. As for the suspected persons, as for persons persons whom we want to follow up, we will obtain photos of these persons, these suspicious persons, and this is permitted by the law. It is in relation to prevention and detection of crime. Mr. Yu Siwei.
Mr. Chairman, I support the development system because the old system has been there for 10 years or so. If we don't have a new system, we'll be lagging behind. It will take about 4 more years to have the new system. Will the administration therefore add more resources in the interim to deal with the crowding situation at the border checkpoints? That is crowding at the airport, at Lo Wu and at Huang Gang. I hope the administration will not reduce resources because of upgrading, reducing manpower resources because of upgrading the system. In respect of inadequate manpower, we've already applied to the administration and we have to follow the procedure and wait for the outcome. The Immigration Department has applied for increase in manpower. Apart from increasing manpower, what more can the department do? There will be deployment according to the need of the time. Say during festivals, more manpower will be deployed so that officers who have less work will be deployed to the front line to do the work, and by flexible deployment, there will be more frontline officers at the front line to do the work. Thank you.
I'd like to know whether you will provide a performance pledge. For instance, to what extent can waiting time of passengers or visitors be reduced, because this is important to Hong Kong as a metropolis. Indeed, we have performance pledges at the airport. We have to ensure that 95% of the visitors can complete the immigration clearance within 15 minutes. For other control points, 95% of the visitors should be able to complete the clearance within 30 minutes. We have been able to meet the pledges in both aspects. So the head of department will deploy manpower appropriately and sure to meet the performance pledges. Mr. Paul Jie, in principle, we agree that the Immigration Department should upgrade its facilities from time to time and ensure that we have state-of-the-art technology to meet with the demand associated with growth in visitors. All right. Regarding the proposals, I have two questions. It seems that situation is quite serious. We have the e-channels, express channels, and multi-purpose e-channels, so on and so forth. I'd like to know whether the three e-channels are just the same, because if some of the e-channels are phased out, then they will make our investment obsolete. And then I think e-channels were only introduced in 2009, and then all the express e-channels were introduced in 2009, and then the process time can be shortened by 8 seconds. And then we also have key holders here. I'd like to know whether the visitors will require to have the same technology in their travel documents, because for less advanced countries, they may not be issuing documents with the similar technology that may offset the effect of our upgrading. All right, I will answer this briefly, and then I will ask Mr. Chow, who is responsible for information technology of the department, to answer. The reason why we want to have multi-purpose e-channels and face recognition technology is because of international developments. IACO, an organization under the UN, has a number of countries as members, including China. There's an agreement that future new passports should contain biometric technologies. The two most reliable technologies currently are either fingerprint or face recognition. According to the U.S. Research Center, face recognition technologies is 99.7% reliable, much higher than 99.4% using fingerprint. But of course, that is the U.S. Own study, and the situation in Hong Kong can only be sure after we have introduced that technology in Hong Kong. Thank you. Mr. Yip, I have to declare interest. We have companies under my group providing cloud computing. I have to declare interest here. According to the under secretary, the reliability will be 99.9%. I'd like to know whether it will be much faster than clearance using our current counters. And we understand that they will use digital data stored in the photo of the travel document for face recognition. We have heard of fake passports. I'd like to know whether 3D technology in passports is difficult to duplicate, and will we have to change Hong Kong's passports in order to comply or in order to be compatible with the new system? Firstly, we have different types of users of our e-channels. For Hong Kong residents, they can continue to use their ID cards or fingerprint for immigration clearance. For people who are holding passports and after enrollment, they can also use e-channels. The purpose of enhancing our e-channel is to ensure that all e-channels will be able to cope with all types or all groups of visitors. But when the scheme is implemented, we will specify e-channels for Hong Kong residents and e-channels for visitors. We have a title arrangement. When there are more Hong Kong residents than visitors, we will designate more e-channels for Hong Kong residents and vice versa. As regards the technology, IACO has very
ICAO, International Civil Aviation Organization, has very high technical specifications. So all member states are quite comfortable with the new technology. In fact, some European countries have already adopted face recognition technology. And in some countries, no prior enrollment is required. So EU countries feel that this is a safe technology. And according to exhibitions we've seen, they do not use 3D technology. Different countries have different technology, but they must comply with the standards set by ICAO. Our specifications are in compliance with the ICAO standards. Come 2016, when we have this technology, there will be about 60% of our visitors using this technology. Ms. Sitho? Thank you, Chairman. We understand that staff of the Immigration Department is very tight at control points. As discussed in a previous meeting, many immigration officers could not take their annual leave, although they have accumulated many days. I'd like to know the percentage of manpower saved as a result of the scheme. Will you be able to ease the workload of our immigration officers? First, will there be increase in manpower? And because while you upgrade the system, there may be more control points and the immigration activities activities there may be more busy. And the system can only start after in 4 years' time. In the interim, what can you do to ease the workload of immigration officers at control points? Because even if you have technology and system, there can sometimes be mistakes. For instance, Yu Man Hon crossed the border point without anyone knowing. So in the coming 4 years, what temporary measures do you have to rectify the situation? Undersecretary, thank you, Ms. Sitho, for your question. When we say manpower is tight, well, we are talk about two things. First, a general shortage of manpower, and there are established procedures for the Director of Immigration to apply for extra resources from the administration to increase manpower. This the director has already done. And the second aspect is, if we adopt more automation, we will lessen the demand for manpower. The annual growth rate of visitors is about 10.76%. And our estimated reduction in manpower requirement is based on this figure. So, we will have more e-channels, we will boost the capacity of icons, and we will turn some counters to e-channels, and we will also apply for manpower, and we believe this will address the question of manpower shortage. Mr. Lam Tai Fai, thank you. Hong Kong is a major metropolis. To increase our attractiveness, we must attract more people to come to Hong Kong for business, for sightseeing, for leisure, for shopping, whatever. I am sure we will have a more rapid increase of visitors from the mainland. According to the administration, the system is already saturated and it must be upgraded as soon as possible. Yes, I understand this, but we have to compare with other systems. In terms of its capacity, safety, ability to deal with emergency situation and other things. How does our new system compare with similar systems being used by, say, Japan, the U.S., and our neighboring countries? I'd like to know what standards the administration is targeting at. Please tell us, how do we compare with our neighboring countries? The system will only be available in 2016. Now, we keep attracting new visitors to Hong Kong. How long can the new system last? How long will it be able to cope? Will it reach capacity by 2019 or soon afterwards? Right, I'll talk about our efficiency and then comparison with overseas systems. I'll ask the ID to respond. Now, the system will be 2.5 times faster than our officer manned counters. And therefore, our ability to cope with visitors will also be increased by 1.25%. And as for face recognition technology, the processing time will be very similar to the fingerprint technology. We will have more booths or channels as a result. And how can we increase the capacity of our system? First, this is an open system. We don't have to purchase patented software. We can buy any new software available in the market, and there is no limit to its expansion in capacity. I think the development within 5 years after 2016 will be able to be satisfied by our system. All right, time's up. Information quickly. Staff of the Immigration Department, what is the situation of their leave communication? Is it true that many of the officers are not able to take leave although they have accumulated a lot of days? Please give us a paper to for information afterwards. All right. A declaration of interest. I forgot to declare interest. A few years ago, our company provided raw materials to the Immigration Department, the plastic membrane. Do you have time for this? No. I already exercised my power to expand the meeting by 15 minutes. So you don't want to know how we compare with other countries? I do. All right, please give us supplementary information after this meeting to satisfy myself and Mr. Lam Tai Fai. I believe, according to members' speeches, we are in general supportive of submitting this paper to the FC for discussion. We have no objection to this, right? We ended the session of this item. AOB, no AOB items. Meeting adjourned. Thank you. 跟住这个